As cannabis continues to be increasingly legalized for both medicinal and non-medicinal purposes, reports of consumption has also increased. Cannabis can be used medicinally to treat pain, but can also be used for non-medicinal purposes such as social purposes, for pleasure, amusement, spiritual, and lifestyle. Cannabis comes in many different forms, such as smoking, vaping, cannabis oil, edibles, and tinctures. These methods have different ways of consumption with different times before the user feels effects, ranging from seconds to 2 hours. These effects can last up to 24 hours. The effects that an individual experiences depends on each individual and different factors such as how it was consumed, dosage, and any previous history with it. There are different possible short-term effects such as euphoria, heightened senses, relaxation, fatigue, and altered cognitive function. Possible long-term effects can include impairment to decision-making, increased risk of a long-term addiction, and if consumed via smoking, damage to lung health. So how does cannabis work? Well, cannabis contains more than 100 cannabinoids, with delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, THC for short, being the main ingredient that alters the brain communication, which produces the feeling of being high. THC is able to bind the receptors on the neurons in the brain, which activates them, which disrupts the physical and mental functions. Affected brain areas include the memory, thinking, concentration, and movement. THC can also activate the brain's reward system, which releases dopamine at high levels, higher than the ones commonly seen in natural rewarding stimuli, which could account for its addictive properties. Another major bioactive component of cannabis is cannabidiol, CBD for short, which doesn't produce the feeling of being high and is used for pain. So that's how it works in adults, but how does it specifically affect mothers and their babies? While the effects of cannabis in adults have had many studies, there are fewer studies conducted regarding the maternal-fetal transfer of THC. That being said, from the studies that have been conducted, it has been observed that the physiological and behavioral alterations may occur in newborns. The Ottawa Prenatal Prospective Study, OPPS, and the Maternal Health Practices and Child Development, MHPCD, found a relationship between prenatal cannabis use and premature births, pregnancy complications, and abnormalities in physical development. Lower Apgar scores have also been observed. Apgar is a test performed at 1 minute after birth, which determines how well the baby handles the birthing process, and it is also performed after 5 minutes, which determines how well the baby is doing being outside the mother's womb. Breathing, heart rate, muscle tone, reflexes, and skin color are all measured. The score ranges from 1 to 10, where any score higher than 7 indicates good health, and lower scores may indicate that the baby requires medical attention. In a more recent study from Corsi and colleagues, studied the association between self-reported prenatal cannabis use and adverse post-birth outcomes. Out of 661,617 women, 9,427 reported cannabis use during their pregnancy, and there was an association of more preterm birth, smaller babies, placental disruption, transferred to a NICU, and a 5-minute Apgar score smaller than 4. In rats, it has been suggested that THC use results in problems with glucose homeostasis in later life. The effects are not limited to babies, however, as there are long-term consequences involved as well. The OPPS and MHPCD studies have also studied the developmental differences of behavior and cognition throughout childhood to early adulthood. At childhood, prenatal cannabis exposure may affect attention and impulsivity, and impaired mental development was observed at 9 months of age for the MHPCD study and 4 years of age in OPPS. In a study from Belhuis and colleagues, it was observed that maternal cannabis use during pregnancy may lead to the risk of psychotic-like experiences in the child at 10 years of age. From adolescence to early adulthood, data has shown reduced visual perception and impulsivity, decreased concentration, visual memory, and verbal reasoning. Increased depression and hyperactivity were also observed. These adolescents and adults have also reported higher rates of cannabis and tobacco use. While these studies have reported their findings, studies determining the relationship between prenatal cannabis exposure and child outcomes may have confounding factors, meaning that there may be other reasons that can also cause the relationship. One such confounder is the usage of other drugs during pregnancy, such as tobacco and alcohol. Cannabis use during breastfeeding may also pose consequences. THC is known to cross the placenta into the baby's blood and can also be transferred into the baby through breast milk. Perez Reyes and colleagues have detected that the THC concentration in milk in women who continued smoking cannabis to be 7.5 times the THC concentration in plasma. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recommends that mothers do not use cannabis products to limit any potential risks. One concern is the secondhand smoke exposure from the result of smoking or vaping cannabis, as this may cause breathing and heart problems in babies that could potentially lead into a sudden infant death syndrome. Additionally, Josen, Shiplow, Fuse, Raha, and Shia at McMaster University published a paper suggesting that for women who use cannabis during lactation, their composition of breast milk is altered. Secretory IgA is an important antibody that helps babies resist infections in the early days of life, and this antibody is decreased in mothers who consume cannabis. While these are the reported risks and consequences from the usage of cannabis during pregnancy and breastfeeding that were found in studies, it is important to speak to your healthcare provider to determine what is best for the mother and the baby. If you or a loved one is seeking help or treatment, there are support available. Help can consist of a multidisciplinary team, including gynecologists, obstetricians, psychiatrists, pediatricians, and social workers, as well as legal advisors who could help provide treatment for cannabis use or dependency during pregnancy. There are different treatments, such as motivation enhancement therapy, which focuses on increasing motivation and setting goals, cognitive behavioral therapy, where negative patterns of thought are challenged to alter unwanted behaviors, and contingency management approach, where motivational incentives are outlined. However, these are just examples, as healthcare professionals would recommend treatments that are adapted to each patient and their needs. While there is limited information regarding cannabis use during pregnancy and breastfeeding, there is evidence showing the risks and consequences that may occur. This video is made for educational purposes, so please speak to your healthcare provider if you have any questions or concerns regarding the use of cannabis during pregnancy and breastfeeding.